So, without any delay, I'd just like to thank you, José Marengo, and have a good class, José.
Thank you. Hello, good afternoon. Buenas tardes. Boa tarde. My name is Jose Marengo. I'm Director of Research and Development of CEMADEN, which is our National Center for Monitoring and Early Warning of Natural Disasters. In the city of San Jose dos Campos, you're going to visit next week. Next week, I will be on vacation, happily, so I will not see you, but our colleagues will give you a nice tour of our facilities. As Tercio mentioned, the way that this school is organized, it follows somewhat the IPCC structure, which is the scientific basics, the working group one, the impacts, adaptation, and vulnerability working group two, and the anti-mitigation working group three. And also some of the intermediate reports, like the SREX, which is a special report on extremes. And also I have added some other information. So as far as I know, all of you come from several countries and from different fields. I mean, just to be curious, who are from the field of meteorology or climatology or atmospheric sciences? Okay. Other fields, social sciences, geography, medical. Good. It's a good variety. I said this because of, since we are talking about basis, scientific basis, I may have to start working with the early concepts, you know, like, for instance, what the greenhouse effect is, and several issues that maybe sound too easy for some of you, particularly for the climatologists, but not for the other ones. And also, from the modeling part, I may have to go from a basics of a climate model limitation and then come with the projections of climate change for the whole world. I mean, sometimes I will have some sort of particular examples for South America, Amazon Basin, Northeast Brazil, but the idea of this workshop is the whole world. So we have divided this in three aspects: introduction, observations, and detection and attribution. All of this will be presented between today and tomorrow. I know after lunch, and many of you have just arrived yesterday, you may be a bit tired. So I hope nobody sleeps. If you sleep, don't snore. But I will do my best to keep this a very dynamic way. I mean, what I said is basically, if any of you have a question, a comment, or curiosity, please feel free to say it anytime. Okay? Otherwise, we may have at the end some questions. And if you want to ask in Portuguese or in Spanish, please do so, no problem. I'm from Peru, so my Spanish is almost perfect. I said almost because of after 20-something years living here, people said I speak very good Spanish, but they don't know that Spanish is my mother tongue. So, okay. The first topic, the first is the introduction in terms of indicator of climate change, treatment of uncertainties. I mean, the title is a bit misleading because what I'm going to talk at the beginning is, for instance, the indications of climate change and uncertainty. It's not just climate change, climate variability. If any of you are from the climate field or geography or any other, you need evidences, you need observations to start working to understand some process. And in the case of meteorology, we rely on observations that could be measures taken directly from the environment, like, for instance, a thermometer, a pluviometer, or a solarimeter, or remote sensing, like the satellites, for instance. And in some cases, we get what we call the paleoclimatic indicators. I mean, indicators which are not instrumental, but may be usable to reconstruct climates in the past. That's what I said, for instance, in BOLT, you have observations on the satellite, on the climate system. With the climate system means the atmosphere, the surface, and water, and cryosphere, and vegetation, and everything, and also the paleoclimate reconstructions. That means that if we want to understand, for instance, the climate of the future, you may need to understand how was the climate in the past. Okay, it's like a doctor. When you go to a doctor first time, he keep asking you all these questions. do you have any historical of heart disease or cancer or things like that, and then start sending you for a lot of medical exams. It's the same case in here. We need observations. We need evidences to do this kind of study. And sometimes, since the last 20 years, we have been relying a lot in satellites, okay? Meteorological satellites, remote sensing satellites, and also paleoclimates. But there is something what we call the uncertainty. Uncertainty in terms, for instance, when you measure temperature, you have several observations per day, sometimes four observations per day, and you get the average. And with the idea of this average, you're sort of trying to reduce the uncertainty. It means, like, for instance, if I take the temperature right here, let's say 22 degrees, you go outside, let's say 18 degrees. So what's the real air temperature, the one in here or the one out there? The one out there. How sure are you that the exact temperature here is 22 degrees? I may take a temperature here, and on the back would be different. So this is what we call degrees of uncertainty, okay? And uncertainty is something that is there. It's always there. What happened, for instance, when you want to issue a forecast? The ideal will be to have 100% exact forecast. But usually, we don't have that. It's made in the best places, it's around 70%. In Brazil, in the US, in France. And there is another 30% which is not accounted for, which is basically what we call chaos, okay? So when you measure uncertainties, for instance, 22 degrees plus minus 3, this is one way of assert uncertainties, okay? Uncertainty is something that is always will be there. Those of you who work with climate models, for instance, you try to improve your models so the uncertainty goes lower and lower and lower. But for sure, you will never have a 0% uncertainty. So if somebody says, oh, this model is 100% certain, well, this may be related to God or something like that, because so far as we know, there are still some issues that we don't know. So uncertainty is based on our scientific understanding. For instance, we know all processes regarding solar radiation, regarding energy balance. We don't know that much, for instance, from the role of aerosols. So there are some uncertainties on that. And when we assess uncertainties, it depends. We may work with probabilities. And usually the uncertainty is based on the type of data, the quality of data, and also something which in IPCC has been very important is this, expert judgment. Which this expert judgment is more like a, I would say, the personal experience of the people. Okay, if you work 20 years in climatology, your judgment will be much better than someone who just started to work. That doesn't mean that we will rely 100% on expert judgment. Expert judgment is basically the last step. You have to make a decision. So what is your own feeling about this, for instance? When sometimes we are summoned by our governors or ministers or deputies or senators, they say, so what's your main conclusion? Oh, it's not going to rain in this region. The drought will continue. That's the way they want to answer. We don't say uncertainties because sometimes the people who don't understand uncertainties believe that uncertainty is error, which is something totally different. Uncertainty and errors are different. Okay? There are statistical ways to measure those. Okay, just to give you a quick example on the Earth system. I think most of you knows about this, but when we talk about the atmosphere, we have the components like the clouds, the ozone, the greenhouse gases, and large aerosols. Some of these aerosols come from volcanic eruptions, like this, or even from land surface processes, like burning biomass burning, and from the aerosols itself. So I think aerosol is a particle. So if this is a particle, they have some weight, and eventually they will fall because of gravity. Gases, no, gases are already there, okay? Among the greenhouse gases, I think you know that CO2 is the most abundant. But we have another greenhouse gas, which is the methane. And methane lasts longer in the atmosphere. It's less proportion, less volume, but it lasts longer. And those two gases are extremely important because of the recent measurement shows that they are increasing concentration, and that may be leading to what we call the global warming. Okay, so we have a natural force, which is the solar output, solar radiation. Some of this solar radiation reaches the surface. Some of this is absorbed by surface, by oceans. Other is reflected. Other part of the radiation is filtered by clouds, by aerosols. Part of this radiation, which is stored by surfaces, later released in the form of heat waves. So you see basically the whole thing as we know it. Okay? We know these processes. Perhaps we know more on long-wave radiation than on gases and aerosols. That's the reason why some of the models don't work that well, because we don't know that much on these processes, and we don't know these processes. We don't know how to parameterize them. Basically, translate a process in a set of equations. If you don't know the process, you don't know what equations to use. Okay? Okay. In the climate system is basically determined by the energy balance. Okay? If we talk about temperatures, higher temperatures, lower temperatures, net radiation, it basically depends on how much energy comes from the top of the atmosphere, how much reaches the floor, how much is absorbed by the atmosphere, how much is reflected by the clouds, and from this, which is reaches the surface, how much is released by the surface, how much of this released by the surface comes back. This is extremely important because the global warming has to do with this. So energy that is supposed to be released to the space, it comes back because the greenhouse gases serve like a blanket. Okay, but we will explain that later on. But since this is a balance, they have to close. Okay, so balance is basically, I mean, if you go to the account and spend more than you have, you will be negative. That's a negative balance. But in reality, it has to be zero. So we have several processes in there. Okay, like for instance, the solar absorbed radiation, the evaporation, sensible heat, latent heat, thermal up surface, thermal down surface. Some of these energies being released by the atmosphere. If you have more greenhouse gases or less greenhouse gases, that's when you may have an imbalance in nature. Okay? And the greenhouse effect. You see, for instance, even in the movies, they say, oh, global warming is will cause the greenhouse effect. Do you think they are right or wrong when they say global warming is because of the greenhouse effect? Why? What else? What else? Exactly. Without the greenhouse gas, our temperature will be extremely low. We will die. So we need that energy coming from the surface and coming back to keep us warm. It's like the same example. I mean, we are feeling cold. You put one blouse. You put seven blouses, you will start sweating a lot. So the idea of the global warming basically comes when we have this concentration of greenhouse gases extremely high, very high. So more energy that is released by the surface comes back. Okay, so it's not the greenhouse effect responsible for global warming. It's the intensification of the greenhouse effect. Okay, it's funny because even the journals like Time Magazine, for instance, they show, oh, global warming because of greenhouse effect. Okay, but it's not that. It's just the intensification of the greenhouse effect. The more gases, the less gases we have, you may see that we may have some problems. But there are some places that are more sensitive. For instance, the United States and China are the two biggest producers of greenhouse gases, particularly the ones coming from oil, gas, and coal, which is the CO2. But the consequences of global warming are felt everywhere. Why? Because of the atmosphere circulation. The winds are bringing all of this. So if somebody says, for instance, that if the U.S. drops from the Paris Agreement, like Teresa mentioned this morning, well, that will be a major problem because gases will be there. China will continue. Probably they will reduce it. But this kind of agreements, it has to be for everyone, everyone. Okay, because what happens in one place it may have consequences in another. For instance, Bolivia, I will show you a picture perhaps tomorrow, that they lost one of the glaciers they have, and a ski resort in the past. And Bolivia perhaps is much, much less producer of greenhouse gases, CO2, than France or Germany. So one of the things of global warming and climate change is particularly the ones, what we call justice of climate. I mean, like the more vulnerable people, the less responsible will be the most affected. Okay, so at the end, these two lines, you can read, adding more greenhouse gases to the atmosphere enhances this effect, making Earth's surface and lower atmosphere even warmer. And this warming extends also to the ocean, not just the air. Well, some example. I mean, this kind of evidence you find on the internet. And 97% of climate scientists agree. Climate change is happening now. It's been driven by human activity, and we can do something to reduce its impacts. So look at this second. It's being driven primarily. If you take primarily, we'll say being driven by human activity. So what in fact is? Global warming, global cooling, they are nature processes. They are natural, climate variability. It has happened in the past without the presence of humans. What humans are doing are accelerating these processes. So according to IPCC, most of the impacts we are having are related to a natural process that is being enhanced by human activities. That's the reason why the Paris Agreement. We don't want to enhance this activity. So whatever happens, we may want to reduce the warming so the impacts will be lower. Okay? And we can do something to reduce its impacts and progression. This is what will be discussed later by Ines Camiloni and Holm Thyssen in terms of this intention on the Paris Agreement to have to limit the warming to 1.5 or even 2 degrees centigrade. Okay? That's one way to reduce that, reducing this deforestation or reducing the release of greenhouse gases. But in terms of variability, weather, climate variability, and climate change. Whether it's the temperature, humidity, and precipitation at a given time in a specific region. For instance, you see the weather channel. Weather forecast for today, blah, 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 blah. But I have heard something. The climate for today will be that. So, and what's climate? Climate is the average of weather over a long, long time period, 30 to 50 years. We may say, for instance, for the next summer, next year, it's going to be warm and rainy in São Paulo. That's climate. But for today or tomorrow, that's weather. And we talk about climate variability. These are the processes that are basically natural, like El Niño, La Niña, the Atlantic Oscillation. All of them are natural. There is no human activity involved. But human activity can affect the natural climate variability. If you hear, for instance, in the newspapers, winters are very, very cold some days in the U.S., and summers are extremely warm in the U.S., so basically the variability is changing. So the mean, it doesn't make much sense now. The important is the extremes, are the extremes, the variability. And that's what we call the climate change. It's a systematic change in the long-term state of the atmosphere over multiple decades or longer. Okay, so these are the definitions that we are going to start pulling from one another. For instance, when I say El Niño, we talk about climate variability. When we start talking about deforestation, in a model experiment, we may be talking about the climate change. Okay. Well, there are, I mean, I took this from a report produced by the UK. I hope you can read it. But the 5 critical global environmental changes. I mean, if you notice, if the climate change will be everywhere, okay, perhaps in some places less than others. Warming temperatures in the Earth's surface and the oceans. This is one of the examples. It may be different, for instance, in the Antarctic or in the North Atlantic. Glaciers, changes in global cycle, global water cycle on the hydrological cycle. Basically, the hydrological cycle is getting faster, more intense. So what happened? You have precipitation, evaporation, runoff. And imagine this cycle goes faster. Precipitation starts making faster. You may have more extreme rainfall events, some dry situations, dry spells, and even drought. Declining glaciers and the snowpack. Oh, basically in everywhere you see these impacts, satellites and stuff like that, all of them are reducing in time. Sea level rise. It depends. I mean, how do you understand sea level rise? Like, for instance, in the movies, like The Day After Tomorrow, like the level rise and came like that. I mean, that may happen, but not in weeks. That's a process that takes hundreds of thousands of years. But what happened? First, if you think, if you recall, warm water expands. So if the warm water expands, the level will go up. And if over time we have a melting of Greenland or Antarctica, you are putting more ice or fresh water goes up. But the problem is not just alone the sea level. It's that the storms are getting stronger. So the waves may be reaching inside, longer and longer inside. I mean, deep inside the city. Cities that were not affected before by waves or internal now affected because of the global warming. And most of the cities around the world are coastal cities. The most important are coastal cities. So the vulnerability of coastal cities are extremely high. And the other consequence of sea surface temperature increasing is the ocean acidification. That's the main consequence is perhaps the coral bleaching. You have read that in Australia and several other places in the Western Pacific that the coral is almost dead. They are white. That's what is named coral bleaching. I mean, there are others, but perhaps these are the more important. I mean, we can add, for instance, changes in biodiversity, but that falls more in impacts. Like, for instance, the Amazon basin may disappear, and then you will have another type of vegetation, and we may have another type of climate as a consequence of deforestation. Or the permafrost in Siberia may defreeze, may melt, and all of this methane that was accumulated for centuries is released, and suddenly you see a stronger release in greenhouse gases, and this warming could go up. Something what we call abrupt climate change, sudden climate change. I mean, climate change usually is very regular, but you may have jumps in this, and that has happened in the past. Okay? So this figure is from the IPCC. I'm sure that at this time of the day, you will hate this figure, but just to give you an idea. See the first column? You have the CO2, CH4, which is methane, halocarbons, NO2, CO, and several others. Okay? If you see the radiative forcing is basically, it's like, to make it simple, it's like the energy balance in the top of the atmosphere. Okay? So what happened? Lower, you see aerosols and precursors. And what happened? If you see, for instance, some of these bars are to your right, and some of these bars are to your left. What does it mean? The positive forcing to your right means temperature increase. The negative forcing to your left means cooling. It would be very nice if warming and cooling followed the same magnitude and then we basically reached the zero. But it doesn't happen. Why? Because the CO2 is released regularly through respiration processes to burn of fossil fuel and several other activities. The methane also, agriculture, garbage. But the aerosols, it comes more irregular. For instance, you have an eruption of a volcano, like Pinatu or Chichon, or that one from Iceland, which I can't remember the name, or some from Chile also. Those are irregular. It may happen once a year, once every 20 years, but not every day. So we have the volume of aerosols is lower compared to the volume of greenhouse gases. For instance, what happened, if you remember, some of you know what's a climate model. But the climate models were developed during the Cold War. The Cold War at the time that Russians and Americans were thinking in terms of bombarding each other with atomic bombs. And then suddenly you have a fire everywhere, and that fire everywhere may lead us to what at the time it was calling to winter. Cold winter, okay? It didn't happen, but the idea, the model development started from that. So it was an idea from the military, actually, who came then very useful for science, because in most of the countries, you use models to do weather forecasts and climate forecasts. Okay? So the idea, for instance, imagine if all the volcanoes make eruption at the same time, all these ashes will basically block the solar energy and the temperature will go down and may go enter in a winter or glaciation period. Okay, that could happen when we have the eruption of all volcanoes, but it doesn't happen. But it could happen. Okay, but just giving to you the idea, greenhouse gases warm the temperature, warm the planet. Aerosols cool it. Okay, but the imbalance exists because you have more release of aerosols as compared of greenhouse gases as compared to aerosols. And you see, for instance, how this anthropic radiative forcing has goes from 1950, 80, or 2011. So it's going high every time because of the contribution of man-made greenhouse gases. And to do this kind of studies, this I think I mentioned before, but coming back with this, we have several generations of observations. For instance, the development of the capabilities of observations. To study climate, weather, hydrology, we need data. And part of the data comes from this kind of observations. For instance, from pilot balloons, aerosols, aircrafts, rockets, and even satellites. Okay? And you see the number of satellites, data sources coming from the 1996 is going up and up. So we have more satellites in the space, and they are providing more information. So we have a whole generation of satellite data to be used for climate studies. But it's less than 30 years or so. So you just pick the last 20 years. So you may have perhaps knowledge on this particular period when we would like to see the whole period. Okay? So we see the number of satellites have been increasing. And if you see the figure in there, the colors, it shows the first year of temperature record in the Global Historical Climatology Network database. It's a rainfall database from the US. It's available from NOAA, the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration. For instance, the blue means that the data starts between 1900 and 1910. The orange, the data started to be collected between 1970 and 1980s. So you see a total imbalance in there. But what's curious, places like India or even parts of Africa and Australia that were colonized by French, by UK, I mean, when the UK were there exploring India, basically they also started to have meteorological data collected. But in the countries that were conquered by the Iberian Peninsula, Portugal and Spain, basically, I'm not sure if that was the problem, but the data started to be collected later on. So if we have to say, we know better about climate variability in the northern hemisphere as compared to the southern hemisphere. Okay, that's the reason why there are several papers published on climate variability in the northern hemisphere, a few on the southern hemisphere, okay? And as I mentioned before, we go from the several generations of data. I mentioned before the ones with the satellites, which are available from the last 30 years or so. But we have also what we call the proxy sources. Proxy because they are not real observations, but they are indicators, like the rings in tree rings, particularly mid-latitude trees, when we have a warm, dry, cool, wet, the thickness of the tree rings are different. That's the reason why we have all of this arrangement, and it's possible to get a sample of it and start dating each one of each other. So it's a possibility to reconstruct climate from the past. It's not data, but this is an indicator of data, okay? So these maps, they show the oceanic data coverage from the 1950s or so. When we see, let's say, this pink color, or the number of temperature profiles, for instance, just look at this pink color, how is growing since the 50s, 60s, 70s, 80s, 90s. And most of them are related to basically the ships, you know, like going, for instance, from here to there and all of them moving around. Because of, by law, international law, ships and aircrafts, they have to report the meteorological data available. Okay? One of the regions in the southern hemisphere when we have less data is the South Atlantic. Okay? We know, for instance, more on the tropical North Atlantic in South America than in the South Atlantic. There are few data available in there. In the tropical Pacific, after El Niño 1983, all the countries started working together to have a network of data, which actually, you go there, you find this data available online. You can get it now from the last half an hour or so. Okay? But that gives you an idea that some Northern Hemisphere is best documented in terms of data compared to the Southern Hemisphere. Okay? And this is the data that has to do with tides, basically an indicator of sea level rise. And if you go from 1880 to 1990, look at most of the important cities are in the coastal region. And most of the data comes from Europe and Northern Hemisphere. And then starting in the 60s, we started to get some data from the coast of Chile and Argentina and southern Brazil. Okay? This is one of the problems that we have in Brazil, actually. Northeast Brazil, the Amazon region, we almost have no data on sea level rise. Just 1 or 2 years from some particular field experiment. So if somebody says, for instance, okay, here in the mouth of the Amazon River, we have, let's say, what we call the how do you say, manguezales? Manglares, I don't know how to translate it. Mangroves. Mangroves, if these mangroves are invaded by seawater, salty water, we may have an important ecological impact in there. But we don't have that much data, so we cannot say that much that, for instance, in Buenos Aires or in New York. And New York, after the Hurricane Sandy a few years ago, people started to realize that that was a major problem. Okay? And the cost of maintaining these instruments is high, but it's much higher to reconstruct parts of the city. Okay? I mean, since the title says indicators, I mean, these are the indicators, basically, what I was thinking about that. Okay. And some of the data, for instance, what we call the location of the paleoclimatic records. In the year 1000 after the date, 1500 and 1750. And you notice most of the data concentrated in higher latitudes, in the north and some in the south, in Argentina, Chile, in southern Africa, and then in Australia. In the tropical region itself, I mean, just 1 or 2 in northeast Brazil, none in Amazon. So this is another indicator. I mean, like the climate history, as I mentioned before, we want to know the climate in the future. You have to understand how the climate of the present works. And to understand how the climate of the present works, you may have to understand how the climate was in the past and what changed. Well, came nice. I don't think I can repeat that. But. Okay. And just to give you an example of what data is available. The first panel to your left is the radio zone data, which means basically profiles that you get from mainly from airports in there. On the left is the rainfall data. Lower side is the mean temperature data. And in the other side is the maximum and minimum temperature. This is the maps that I got from the World Meteorological Organization. And if you notice, for instance, in parts of the tropical region, particularly in South America, we don't have that much data available. Okay? So different from other regions, like Northeast Brazil, for instance, we know more about the changes in rainfall. But if somebody wants to say, oh, I want to study trends in minimum temperature in Northeast Brazil, is almost no data. It's very, very hard to do that. Okay? With the satellite data, you may have some estimates on what we call the reanalysis. I will explain later on what reanalysis is. We may have some equivalent of data, substitute of data, but not the real observational data. Okay? And as I mentioned before, after the El Niño, 1983, all many countries, including the US, France, they deploy all of this network of oceanic data from temperatures to going down until 200 meters. So we have basically a profile. We have the historic. We do monitoring of temperatures now. If somebody wants to see, is there an El Niño situation starting, you can go there and start looking at the time series to see if there is a El Niño coming or not. And El Niño usually is the warming temperatures in the, no, usually no. It is the warming in the tropical Pacific temperatures. And then on the Atlantic, we have this one, the Pirate Array. Because what happened in the North Atlantic is extremely important for rainfall in Northeast Brazil, in the Amazon, in the Sahel region, and even in tropical Africa. Okay, so you know that climate anomalies are transboundary. They are not limited just to one country. That's the reason why they have more impacts in one country than in another country that could be best prepared to cope with those anomalies. And in terms of the climate indicators, I mean, you don't have to read that. I think that all of this material is going to be available. I'm not sure it will be. But in any case, what meteorologists used as a paleoclimate indicators are the corals. I think everyone knows what a coral is. Fossil pollen. Okay. Some of you are not familiar with Brazilian geography, but we have the state of Pará, which is basically the central Amazon, as you can imagine. Higher temperatures, higher humidity. But in the 10,000 years in the past, there were found fossil pollen from trees which are typical from cool regions, like in Argentina or even southern Brazil. And there were in several places. So what does that mean? That 10,000 years ago, perhaps that region, which is warm and humid now, it was drier and cooler. Okay? And if you find it anywhere else, that may be an indicator that there was another type of climate at that time. And then when the people started studying what could be that type of climate. Tree rings. Tree rings, as I mentioned before, they are the rings that you have in different types of tree. Tropical trees are perhaps not that good indicators because the changes in climate are more extreme in northern and southern hemisphere, the higher latitude. Ice cores. Ice cores are samples of ice taken either from glaciers or from the northern pole. And I will show you some picture of that later on. And ocean and lake sediments. I think it's just, you know what's ocean and lake sediments. But in terms of what I think Cristiano Chiesi is going to talk about more details on paleoclimate. But I will basically touch a little on this because to talk about present and future, we may have to go into the past. And in the past, we have two periods which actually were well documented, the Little Ice Age in 1400 to 1850, and the Medieval Warm Period from 800 to 1400. The Little Ice Age, for instance, I'm not sure if you watch TV, Game of Thrones, I mean, this kind of weather type, that's basically Little Ice Age, because as you know, Game of Thrones is basically fiction, but was based at the times of the Vikings, which actually were that kind of weather. You never see the sun, everything is wearing huge layers of clothes or even skin from animals. And then the medieval warm period, which actually was very warm temperatures, and some of the paintings from some of the masters in painting, they showed that kind of climate. There were consequences of that because of higher temperatures produces disease, okay? So in terms of ice cores, you see, for instance, this is from Cusco in Peru, in Quelcaya, in the Andes in there. This is ice cores. This is like a tube that it's basically penetrating. And each one of the ice cores, and you see this kind of levels, layers of ice, each one represents one particular period of time. Okay, and if you have a sample of this, if you analyze the bubbles of air inside the samples, you may be able to get a reconstruction of what was the concentration of gases in the past. Okay. So what did the scientists do? They take this, and this is the sample of ice they took, and then the air bubbles trapped in ice, they show their indicators like this. Each one of these is the bubble effect. I mean, you take a piece of ice for your drinks, you may find something in there, you know, like these bubbles. This is basically air. And imagine you got, in some way, I don't know how, to get the concentration of CO2, methane, or several other gases in this particular part. And when people, when the scientists start taking this, they sort of, I mean, can you imagine, they cannot get a sample of 20 meters at once. They have to have it and then break it and put it in pieces. So, and then at the laboratory, they start mounting each other. Okay, they do that in the Himalayas, they do that in the Andes, in the Vostok, and even in Antarctica. So, the example of the tree ring. I'm not sure if you can see the what this guy's put it in there, but this is 1660 before Christ, 1600 before Christ, and 1600 before, 6600 before, sorry. So what may happen? There are several indicators, and according to these several indicators, for instance, they come, these kind of observations, the standard deviation on different trees in some particular region, I think it was in Canada. But the idea was to get information from these samples, okay? And then after some sort of calibration, they come with equivalent of temperature. Of course, the uncertainties are high, but at least it's an indicator that temperature in that region was not the same as it was today. And in the US, they were able to reconstruct, for instance, drought in New Mexico. Since three, four years ago, California suffers one of the worst droughts in their history. And then if you see the standard deviation of the precipitation estimate by reconstructed with tree rings, you see the periods in the lower standard deviation, which is the yellow and then the orange. The yellow would say dry conditions, and then the red is drought situation. And this is a nice reconstruction. There have been published several papers that show some particular examples of those, and even they show what circulation changes happened during those times. You see, this is the past, basically. Past. You see that droughts like this, for instance, in 1950, we have had it even worse in 1750, even 1600. So there are droughts that are not unique. They have happened in the past. Perhaps the impacts have been different, because if you say climate is changing now, yes, but vulnerability of populations is increasing. Okay, so that's the worst part. If the climate change and the people gets more vulnerable, you will have more impacts. If it doesn't change and people is well protected, it doesn't matter. You can change and people will not die as a consequence of this. For instance, this is a reconstruction of the drought situation in 1863. The western and central part with dry conditions according to the Palmer Drought Severity Index. This Palmer Drought Severity Index is based on the water balance. So you have negative water balance means negative Palmer Drought Water Index. And then you have the other part of the country, which is the positive side, in Florida and other regions in southeastern United States. And in terms of climate, volcanoes are one source of natural climate variability. And what happened? If you see in the lower side of this, we have first the MCA, Medieval Climate Anomaly, and the Little Ice Age in there. And you have, for instance, in here, the medieval climate anomaly, the temperatures were really higher, and then you have the Little Ice Age. And why they call the Little Ice Age? Because when we talk about Ice Age, we're talking about hundreds of thousands of years, but the Little Ice Age was basically a few hundreds of years. Okay? And you notice these drops in temperature in some places, which actually coincide with the amount of sulfate aerosols indicator from volcanic eruptions. So it's meaning that when we have a volcanic eruption, temperatures in the air go down. And that has happened in 1982, 83, during El Niño. If there was a warming tendency after a volcano, there is a cooling and after 2 years, when all these aerosols came to surface, the temperature continues. Okay, but you have the historical, the history in there. Okay, look at this. For instance, they are from 1800 to 2000, year 2000. So we are closer to here. And some people call the medieval climate change anomaly, which actually had the same order of magnitude of the observed current 20th century warming. But during the MCA, we call it MCA to make it simpler, we didn't have biomass burning, perhaps that much. We don't have that much population. We didn't have strong industries on all companies. So perhaps, and I say perhaps because this is the construction basically, the forcing, anthropogenic forcing, was lower during the MCA. It was more natural. And in our recent warming, is perhaps natural, but also the anthropogenic forcing seems to be higher. But once in a while, we have a volcano activity, and this volcano affects the natural climate variability. There are several periods. I mean, I'm just going to the last 2,000 or 3,000 years, but I will show you some examples of 800,000 years with the reconstructions in there. Like this, for instance. This goes to 650,000 years in the past. The zero is the present. And if you notice, for instance, the CO2 in red, the methane in blue, an indicator of temperature, which is the isotope of that, is a black line. So what happened? The changes in CO2 and methane sort of go together with the changes in temperature. If we say, for instance, we're somewhere here, nearby here, zero is our present time, you may see the human influence is stronger here. We have high levels of CO2, we have high levels of methane, higher temperature. But in the past, we have had this kind of events. You see? So, that's what I said. I mean, some of the climate change skeptics says that first, sometimes they don't interpret well the IPCC reports, because the IPCC reports, they don't say that humans are responsible for climate change. They say that the influence on human signal in climate change is significant, which is a bit different. Okay. So what happened? We have these kind of changes in the past, natural climate variability. We may have these kind of changes in the future again as natural climate variability, but the human influence is making stone changes stronger. So we may have higher warming now than 400,000 years ago because of the human activity. But if you take out the human activity, the warming would still be there. This is what we call attribution. Okay, we will see tomorrow afternoon. If you see the climate changing, what are the causes of it? So we attribute the causes of climate change to something. We will see what something is tomorrow. And going from different time scales, in up there, we go from 200,000 to 800,000. You see the previous ice ages in the past, a little ice age in there, but we have several other previous ice ages in the past. And in the lower side, we just take one example, the little ice age and the Holocene. I'm not sure what you know what the Holocene is. Any? Not that much as the Little Ice Age. The Little Ice Age was relatively 1400, 1300. The Holocene was 6,000 years, 10,000 years. So the Holocene was perhaps the last period when we have a natural climate forcing, which means what? The excess of the air was this, and it changes to the other way. What produces that? We don't know. But if you do, if the planet changes, suddenly tilts, we have totally different distribution of climate. Regions that used to be warm are becoming cool. And this fossilized pollen, in Pará, for instance, it happens during this particular period. So the idea of the Holocene as a period during a major climate change happens was the typical example of the last climate change, 100% natural, not human. Okay, so the natural climate change has been happening in the past. What we have now is perhaps a small period with human impacts. But like I said before, in the past we have higher temperatures, we have lower temperatures. In the present, we are having those as it should have in the past, but the frequency of those, the intensity of those, have been changing because of the human activities. And this is a picture, a painting. The frozen Thames River in London, it's 1677. And you see, for instance, it was frozen. Why it was frozen? It was London. The dating of this painting is basically during the Little Ice Age. So those of you who know London knows that it's not like this. So it's amazing, but some of these paintings are also indicators of what could happen in the past. We use these paintings as climate proxy. So this is a confirmation that, in fact, there wasn't any picture at the time, but those were good enough to say that it really happens. Okay. You have any question, please feel free to ask any time. Any question? Any? Yes. No, I think they are recording it, so whatever I said may be used against me, so.
In your previous slide, you mentioned about natural climate variability through the attribution.
Yes.
Over thousands of years, you see the natural climate variability.
Yes.
Now, when we try to define what climate is, it is over a period of 30 to 50 years. So how useful that definition that we are putting forth is going to be in terms of impact evaluation?
Okay. The idea of 30 to 50 years, it comes from the definition of the World Meteorological Organization. So every meteorological institution working with basically follow the regulations of the World Meteorological Organization. So it means that to have the average to define climate consistent, it has to be a minimum of 30 years. You have 60 years, even better, but you have 20 years. You may have your mean, but it's not as consistent. So this is our definition, and most of the climate anomalies are defined based on 1861 to 90, for instance. But that's just one small piece. But if we go back into the past or go into the future, sometimes we are taking the 30-year example like this. So it doesn't matter. It doesn't make any sense, I would say. But for present climate, it's extremely important. But for this, for instance, it didn't matter. But at least it's a proof that we have cooling conditions and London and other places, and we have the paleoclimate indicators that actually the Little Ice Age has happened in the past. Okay? Yes? And on the back also, there is someone over there.
I have a question about the drought, reestablishing the history of drought. I think it was the United States.
Yes.
And that, how is that reestablished, from tree rings or from all the different paleo data? How did they get that accurate reestablishing of the droughts, you know, year upon year?
Yeah, well, there are so many details, like, very hard to explain, but they usually have whatever it comes from the samples of trees or even the ice, is going to a calibration. So it has to be calibrated with observations in climate chamber. So they have a basic indicator. That's the reason what I said, what you get, like, for instance, -3 Palmer drought for 1850 or even 1750 is not an observation, it's an indicator. So if somebody says, what's the uncertainty of this? The uncertainty of this is very high, particularly in the older periods. But at least there are indicators that this kind of drought has happened in the past. Okay, maybe it was not a drought, but there was a drought, basically. Okay. There are so many details, actually, I don't even know some of them, but there are, as far as I know, there are calibrations. They are well calibrated, so there is some credibility on this. I mean, there are several papers published with this kind of indices. Yes, there was one in the back, I think.
Hi. Do we know what if there's a regular period to the shifting of the axis on the Earth? A periodicity of that?
We don't. As far as I know, we don't. I mean, the idea of finding a period of this, for instance, going back in the past, may say something in the future. You know, like, for instance, if suddenly there is a Holocene-like tilting of the Earth, we will end our problem of global warming. You see? But we don't know that. I mean, it is one of those things that we call abrupt. Like, for instance, the impact of a meteor 65 million years ago in the Yucatan Peninsula, Gulf of Mexico, it happened. But we don't have a periodicity of this kind of event. This is the kind of event that we call sudden events, abrupt events. It may happen in the past. It may happen again in the future. But we don't know when. You see, most of these climate projections we see, the one we will show tomorrow, they are just projections. Why? Imagine if the Greenland melts and the whole thing goes into the ocean. The sea level rise will increase meters. But the projections of IPCC models, the highest is 60 centimeters because it didn't include the melting of the Greenland. You see, but could happen, it can happen. You see, but this is the kind of uncertainties we have. So the idea is to know the history, but going back in the past, we still have some uncertainties in our history. We know it happens, we know it was dry, for instance, in the case of the Southwest USA, but we don't know if it was exact as dry as 2013-2014 drought in California, for instance. Any other question?
You have mentioned that without even without the human interpretation, the climate may be changed. And is there any way to just quantify what is the contribution from the anthropogenic activities on the climate change, especially on the global warming?
Yeah, that's a topic that we will discuss tomorrow because of there are a few groups actually from the UK. Oxford and University of Exeter in the U.S., they come with this, I have to admit, very complicated statistical techniques, fingerprints and things like that. They are able to quantify the influence in one and another. And with usually using climate projection. Because imagine this, for instance, just, let's say, talking about something tomorrow. If you see the observations in temperature, it goes this way. If you see the climate models forced with natural variability, the warming goes this way. But if you combine the natural and the anthropogenic variability to the model, they sort of reproduce quite well the observations. And tomorrow I will show you, and even I think there are some publications which I asked to put on the side, that this attribution, for instance, is this particular heat wave related to human influence? There are several papers starting to be published on that. And tomorrow I will show you some examples that some particular events are just natural climate variability and the others are human signals in there. Okay, so, I mean, it's something relatively new, the attribution. That's what we call the attribution of climate change. It's something relatively new. Yes? Any other?
Just one point related to the period for the normals.
Yeah.
So it used to be that you computed the normal for 1961 to 1990, isn't it? And recently it has changed, the WMO changed it to 1981, I think, 2000 or something. And I find it misleading because now people or the meteorological agencies are giving the precipitation deficit based on these new normals and not the previous one. So it leads you to the conclusion that you know there is no climate change somehow. It's mm-hmm. It diminished the change. So I would like what you think about this change in general for the perception of the change.
Yeah, for a long time, the 1961 to 90 was the signal, the reference. So if you apply to temperature, the current temperature, the anomaly will be much higher using 61 to 90 to, let's say, 80 to 2010. But for precipitation, as you said, the anomaly in rainfall comes lower. I think IPCC uses now the 1970 to 2000. Yeah, in the fifth assessment report, they changed it because there were complaints from the governments and scientists saying that if you use the 1961 to 90, our temperature anomalies will be too high. But it comes the problem of the rainfall anomalies will be too low. And actually, for somebody who is not a believer of climate change, that will be good enough to say there is no climate change, it's just climate variability. Okay, so we can discuss that tomorrow when I touch this issue. But it's a 30-year average. But the 30-year average using temperature is going higher and higher each time. Okay? Any other question?
Okay. My point is, you know, the proxies we consider, they are not all the same for all places. You know, in some parts we consider sea level rise, and other places for the precipitation and the climate, the temperature, the minimum, maximum data. Some places do not have even the data at all, like places in some parts of Africa. Mm-hmm. And the average, which we consider like 30 to 50. Can you consider that having the available data and the perception of the people, can you consider that the climate is changing?
Yeah, the perception of people, it's a good forcing, I would say. Mm-hmm. Because, for instance, if you think in terms of some studies we did on sea level rise in the Santos, port of Santos in São Paulo, we don't have data enough, you see. But something that is going on is like for the 10 years of data we have, not 30 years or so, there was a bit higher and higher. And the storms and waves, they are going higher inside. I mean, there are places that now they have these parkings down there. And those, some of the places got flooded by water. And then when somebody start asking people in terms of, what do you think about this? In terms of just asking the normal people, regular people. Mm-hmm. I mean, that all of us are regular, but they're talking about the people that are not working with science, just the housewife and things like that. They start having this perception that climate is changing because they saw, for instance, that their parking lots get flooded in the last 2 years. It didn't happen 20 years ago. So one of the situations, like we have data, but in some places where we don't have that much data, we rely also on perception of the public. And sometimes the elders are a good source of information because they say, oh, at the time I was 7 years old, it was like raining a lot, and now it doesn't rain. It doesn't mean that we take it for granted, but we put in this evidence together with several others allows us to give a clear picture of that, and the public perception is extremely important. Okay?
Thank you.
I think there was another one, and then we reassume our... just want to make you awake, because there's some faces going down. At what time is the break? Sorry. Oh, really? Oh, my goodness. Okay, one more question, if we continue, please.
Just a quick question following up on the drought.
Yes.
Are you aware of any data, historical data, which goes back 2,000 years or even less for the northeast of Brazil, particularly that region or any part of Brazil, looking at drought, as you demonstrated with New Mexico? Is there any equivalent data?
No. Actually, my group and others have published a couple of papers on that, and because of we are in the middle of a drought, in the drought that started in 2010. It's a 7 year drought. Usually, El Niño produces drought, but as soon as El Niño is over, the situation goes to no. So we have 7 years drought. And people is still deciding what is that, is climate change or not. So we don't have that much history in terms of data. But there are reconstructions of El Niño. You see, like in the northern coast of Peru, one of the sources, I mean, in general, one of the sources of data were the clergy that came up with the conquerors, you know, taking notes and things like that. For instance, in the northern coast of Peru, it's a desert. But according to one priest, took note, we came in the green region in the northern part of Peru. It has to be El Niño. You see? So there was an El Niño at that time. We don't know what intensity. Things happened in 1877 and 78. There was a major drought in India. Millions of people died. At the same time, the same year, there was a major drought in northeast Brazil, where 700,000 people died. Coincidence or not, that was an El Niño year. You see? But now, changes are changing. El Niño is no longer responsible for droughts. Droughts in the Amazon and northeast Brazil without El Niño. So what we learned in the past basically is breaking. But we have this data, but we don't have, unfortunately, this kind of reconstructions in northeast Brazil. I have been looking through it, I cannot find. Perhaps the oldest data, I mean, in the past we go is 19. Fortaleza in 1865, but Fortaleza is in the coastal region. And the drought region is in what we call the semi-arid region, which is the lowest part, the most vulnerable when poor people live in there. So, unfortunately, we don't have this kind of history. But if any of you find it, please let me know, because it's something we are looking forward for decades. Okay. We will continue. Going back a little with the observations, and I think in terms of, since the title of the session is indicators, we have to explain a bit more in observations. We have the typical rain gauges. We have, for instance, the radars now that they provide also information, not just on rainfall, but also in convection, clouds, hail, and the satellites. Several generations of satellites going on now, the TRIM, which is rainfall and convection activity. GRACE is the satellite that allows to measure changes in water level. It has been used to assess for changes in river level in the Amazon during droughts, and also changes in water level as an indicator of sea level rise. And we have several others that have providing with MODIS, for instance, is extremely important because it provides information on aerosols coming from biomass burning. Okay, and satellite observations are considered observations itself. I mean, they have to go to a calibration process, but are reliable. The only problem is the shortness of record. It's less than 30 years or so. Okay, I don't like this figure, so let's go. It's clear that when we think in terms of temperature, if temperature is going higher each time, the first thinking comes maybe the sun activity is going up also. Okay, and some of the observations that show that the changes in the solar activity, irradiance, has not been as strong as we expect. So it hasn't changed that much. And there are observations that show. So basically, the solar forcing is much less forcing than the greenhouse forcing. So it means that there is no observed trends in solar radiation. So changes in solar radiation alone cannot explain the increases in air temperatures or sea surface temperatures. There is some set of data, what we call the reanalysis. I'm not sure how many of you are familiar with reanalysis. Can you raise your hands who are familiar with the reanalysis? Well, to make it simpler, imagine that you have a map with data, temperature, precipitation, humidity, winds, and there are places where you don't have data. Okay, so imagine that you get a climate model. All of these observations that you find are assimilated, meaning fed into the model, and the model comes with a product which says basically precipitation, temperature, wind data everywhere, including in regions where there is no data. How this region with no data suddenly comes with data? Because the reanalysis, the models, they have different levels of equations that take the process and do this kind of interpolation. Not linear interpolation, it's dynamic interpolation. So the reanalysis come like a data sets now. They are not called observations because they are not observations. They are a mix of observations and model estimates. For instance, in the US, you have great coverage of precipitation data. So what the reanalysis shows in rainfall in the US perhaps is closer to observations. But when you have in the Amazon, when there is not much data available, with the reanalysis you get rainfall data. But perhaps the rainfall data, they have high uncertainties as compared to observations. Okay? But the first thing that we see is rainfall, and rainfall is the most complicated variable. But the winds are there. For instance, if all the winds in northeast Brazil comes from the northeast because of the trade winds, the reanalysis, they show the same. So it's a quite consistent dynamic pattern. And this kind of reanalysis has been produced for several climate centers. You see, for instance, the one produced by the NOAA, the National Oceanic Atmospheric Administration, the CIRES, which is the University of Colorado, the National Center for Environmental Predictions, the European Center for Medium Range Weather and Forecast, the Japan Meteorological Agency, another generation of Japan Meteorological Agency, the NASA, and several data centers, several numerical data centers, they produce their own reanalysis. So, and look at that. Some of them, the periods go back in the past, like 1871. Most of them started in the 50s or even in the 70s. Anti-resolution, basically the size of the grid, is 300 kilometers or something like that. So why this is important? Because when we want to do a global study, for instance, of changes in the wind, let's say it's the intertropical, the rainfall in the Sahara, the sub-Sahara, and northeast Brazil, both semi-arid regions, we want to study the changes in winds in the last 50 years. We may have some wind data in the ocean because of the network I showed before, but we have the reanalysis that can help us to do this kind of analysis. So the reanalysis is basically a set of data which are close to observations. They are generated by models. Whenever there is no data, the model simulates the data based on the neighboring stations in there. And it is the best when you have data. Regions with good coverage, the reanalysis are excellent. Regions with bad coverage of data, the reanalysis are still in doubt, the uncertainties are high. And I say this because several of you, particularly the ones studying meteorology, they use, for instance, the European Center reanalysis or the ENSEP reanalysis to do the circulation studies. And it's funny because this is the European Center for Medium Range Weather Forecast, which is based in Reading, UK. And now with UK, England, out of the European Union, people is wondering if we'll call European Center or British Center, because the European Center is a European Center. You go there and find people from the whole Europe working in there, not just the UK. And now with this kind of political situations, that's like I said, this reanalysis may be changing because of models. I mean, we call it reanalysis because you have the model. But suddenly someone comes with a better version of the model. So you redo the whole thing. That's what we call reanalysis. Okay? So I'm sure some of you will never see those, but at least to know that it's a possibility of having data which is a blend of model and observations. Okay? Any question on that? Any doubt on that? And also the observations from the satellite in terms of sea level rise, snowpack. In 70 to 2000, in 2007, 2012, you see the size of the Arctic Sea is going down. Some years it goes up, but in general the tendency is going down. Greenland is there over there. I'm sure that all of you know that Greenland belongs to what country? Iceland? I keep asking that to my tropical meteorology students. They never get it right. We have Iceland here. Anyone else? We have Denmark here. Anyone else from here, anywhere? It's Denmark. Okay? Denmark, not Iceland. It's somewhere there, but it's not Denmark. But just figures like this are available on the internet. You just go there and find. And you can also have, for instance, you have the square miles that will actually growing, you know, like the number of miles of the area covered by snow that keep changing every time. Okay? And some of the examples we have in Peru, the Andes in Peru, in the central Andes. I mean, if you go take a picture somewhere in some particular time or another, you see that some of the glaciers are retreating, basically going back or basically disappearing. Now, the Andes is a good example on that. And this is the one from Chacaltaya. It used to be a ski resort. Now you don't see snow at all. And this is in Bolivia. No? This was extremely important because besides providing comfort in terms of skiing, this snow in the Andes, the Bolivian Andes and Peruvian Andes, they provide fresh water for the population. So you don't have snow, you don't have a ski, but also you don't have water to drink. And Bolivia last year experienced one of the worst droughts in 25 years or so. And it was one of those typical examples. No? The scientists said, we are going to have a drought. We are having a drought. The government don't give any attention to that. And suddenly they realize, and the president start fighting the directors of hydrology and meteorology. With that, you don't solve the problem. You actually make it even worse. Okay? So somebody has to pay for that. Actually, it has to be the government because it didn't take care of this situation. Droughts happen in the past and will continue happening in the future. I have to be prepared for that. Okay? And the NOAA, the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, publishes regularly this kind of analysis. This is, for instance, May 2007. I was looking for June 2017, sorry, but I couldn't find it. But this is basically the temperature percentiles, temperature trends. You see the red, darkest red is the record warmest, pink, warmer than average. And basically everywhere is warmer than average, with some exceptions like in the US or even in the northern part of Europe or even some part of the Indian Ocean in the southern part, which are actually cooler than average. But most of these pictures, they show the red color, which means temperature higher. It could be, some of you can say, okay, but this is over a city, yes, there is some sort of urbanization effect on the warming, but basically it's there warming. This warming doesn't separate the signal or the natural climate variability. Okay? It doesn't separate, just say that it's warming. And this is some of the extremes. Every year, this center produces and assesses extremes, depending on region do you want to see. For instance, you want to see Australia. May 2017 was warm and dry in Australia overall. Has its 21 highest May temperature and the 26 driest May on record. So these kind of records are assessed and archived. If you go to NOAA site, you can get all these figures from, I think, the 2000 year. I mean, it's kind of nice using, if you are working, teaching, these kind of examples are very nice because they give you an idea that there are evidences of changing in the weather everywhere, not just in US countries or Europe, but also in South America. In Argentina, for instance, locations have twice their normal precipitation, and Antarctica sea ice is below the 1980 to 2010. And you see 1980 to 2010, no? 1960 to 1990. So they are changing the pattern in some regions, okay? So this is just an example of higher temperatures and impacts everywhere. The average of that from northern hemisphere, southern hemisphere, and global. Okay? This is related to 1961 to 90. So you see, there were some periods in the past that were warmer than normal, like the ones in the 50s, for instance. But now, since the 70s or 80s, we have this going up, this trend tendency. And at that time, 1998 was the warmest because it was an strong El Nino year. But now you see that this warming is gradual, is going every year. There was a small period at the end of the century, this one, that some people called the hiatus, means like the cooling tendency. And they thought that perhaps this cooling tendency means that global warming is over. No, it was just a small down and going up again. And the data shows everywhere that. This is a global map. If you do it for cities, you may have the same signal. Okay? This is just an example of what the center showed. From several data sets, you have the historic temperature in 1850, for instance. The first one is temperature, land temperature, sea surface temperature, marine air temperature, sea level data sets in terms of sea level rise, and extent of the ice, sea ice. And if you notice, all of the temperature data shows increase. There are few data sets available For instance, one particular center created their own data sets of rainfall. They used the same stations, but the interpolation techniques were a bit different. That's the reason why it showed up as different data sets, but all of them, they showed the same tendency. Okay? Notice, for instance, that we are into warming now, but in the 40s, there was another warming period. The sea level rise is going up, and the temperatures are going up. The ocean heat content is going up. So all of the signals in there, this is observations and data, shows that temperatures are going up. We're not talking about models. This is data. Okay, so basically, the present. Our present starts on 1850 approximately. Okay, it's not just the last decade or so. So, just to recall what climate variability and changes. For the past million years, our climate has had many significant changes. Changes in air climate are triggered by changes in air energy balance. Long-term changes like continental drift, changes in Earth's orbit. Shorter changes like volcanic eruptions and oceanic currents. Okay, like the Holocene, for instance, changes in Earth's orbit. It took lasted like 6,000 years or so. The volcanic eruptions, 1-2 years. Okay, so they are different time scales. But all of these are natural. That's what we call climate variability. Climate variability means that the climate is changing as it should be anytime without any human influence. Now, in terms of the definition of climate change, I mean, everyone may have their own definition. If we rely on the one that IPCC has produced, which is published on the IPCC glossary, it's a change which is attributed directly or indirectly to human activity that alters the composition of global temperature atmosphere. And in addition to natural climate variability observed over compared time. So you have the natural climate variability, you have another signal over the natural climate variability, which is the human-made signal. And when people start talking about climate change, it's basically anthropogenic climate change. Okay? If we are talking about climate change of natural causes, it's basically climate variability. And one of the consequences of global warming is that natural climate variability is changing. So what is the forcing? Global warming is the forcing to climate change. Okay? Global warming is the forcing of climate change. So who is responsible for the global warming? Well, you have natural and human influences. So if the climate is changing, it's because natural and human influences. And what IPCC shows are that the signal of human influences are getting each time significantly important. Okay? Internal variability. Internal variability. Future climate will be partially determined by external forcing, like, let's say, El Niño, the variations in the Pacific, year to year to decade scale fluctuations, and also the changes in human activity and major volcanic eruptions. Okay, so all of them, they contribute. In some years, you may have various volcanic eruptions. In other years, in decades, we may have not any. So the influences keep changing every time. But something has to be very careful is to attribute one particular phenomenon to climate change. For instance, in Brazil, there was a rainfall episode yesterday that killed 20 people. A journalist keeps saying, is that climate change? We said, no, you cannot attribute one particular event to a longer time process. It may happen that these extreme events are going more frequent every time, means that in that case, we can say that people die because of possibility of climate change. But one particular isolated event, it may not be necessarily related to climate change, maybe not necessarily related. Because what I'm going to show you tomorrow is that the British and several other groups, using the most sophisticated statistical techniques, they found some signal. I must just give you the conclusions. On the documents you are going to receive, you will see the whole paper, and by yourself you can see actually how did they calculate this. If you manage to understand, please let me know, because I really don't. Okay? Okay, some of the changes in orbital changes, you know, like for instance the ones, equinox and things like that, and could happen that the axis of the tilting of the axis may determine warmer summers and cooling winters, but in different regions. A region that may have a warm summer may have in the future a cooler region. Okay? And among the natural causes, we have the volcanic eruptions there, as I mentioned. Together with the volcanic eruptions, we have the greenhouse gases, deforestation. When I talk deforestation, it's not just deforestation of the Amazon region or tropical vegetation. Deforestation of a savanna-type vegetation, for instance, is extremely important. Coal mining, burning of fossil fuels, industrial processes, most of them related to fossil fuel, and agriculture. Agriculture is one of the main sources of food also, but it's one of the main sources of methane. Okay, so agricultural is also one of the ways that humans help to increase the intensity of the greenhouse effect. So just to summarize this part, the human-made gases, we have the CO2, the methane, nitrous oxide, and halocarbons, CFC. CFCs, for instance, are extremely important because of the effect they may have in the ozone hole, the ozone layer in there, okay? And then the others are related to warming. Carbon dioxide is the one who actually is the most important in terms of percentage. But the methane is the most dangerous because of the residence time is extremely higher. And the halocarbons were sort of prohibited after the Montreal Protocol because the freezers and refrigerators, they use this gas a lot, the freon. And it was sort of reduced, but it's still there, but it's going down, okay? While carbon dioxide and methane are still going high. And the changes of climate change. I said, for instance, emission of pollutants. That's just the, in that case, for instance, CO2 released by industry, fossil fuel. But changes in land use. I think you're going to have some sessions in land use, but changes in land use. What do you mean changes in land use? For instance, if you destroy a natural biome to create a city, it's land use. If you cut trees to create agriculture and agribusiness in there, it is land use. Okay, if you want to have rice in a region that used to be savanna, for instance, that's land use. So land use is changing whatever native vegetation, you have to have something else. And you have a city, for instance, that's totally different albedo and totally different energy components. You may alter the hydrological cycle, and you may alter also the rainfall. I mean, the reason to having this workshop at this time of the year, it was because in summer, it rains like crazy. And the city is basically like a huge swimming pool. It's totally covered. So when there is rain, some of the streets are flooded. And in 2014, we have a major drought in here. So I remember we got a phone call from a woman saying, I have no water at home, but my street is totally flooded. Can you explain me that? It's extremely hard to explain. You see, it's totally different. Because if you don't have the city, but you still have the natural vegetation, and this water just comes and starts filtering like any hydrological process, okay? Deforestation. Farm animals release methane from their waste. So in a future society, for instance, those these Star Trek-type movies, they say, I want to order a hamburger from a food replicator. Oh, what you have is not a real hamburger. It's equivalent because the cows were prohibited because of the methane. So they killed the whole cows just to avoid the methane. This is very, in Brazil at least, it's very unlikely to happen because Brazil loves meat, okay? And the other is smoke and pollution from factories, industry. Remember that some of the concerns of the climate skeptics is saying that climate change is something that the rich countries create to stop development of poor nations. It's not that true, but the problem is the only development we know is based on fossil fuel, which is not the best development. It's not sustainable. Okay? But the idea is to reduce this. That's what the Paris Agreement is this, basically to reduce the fuels. I mean, if China can do it in 25%, if any country can do it in just 1 or 2%, it's important. But if U.S. don't want to do it because they say it complicates their economy, that's fine. But at the end, Mother Nature is really very clever. George Bush filio was president when he didn't like to ratify the Kyoto Protocol. And how Mother Nature revenge? They sent Hurricane Katrina, where 1,500 people died. The same thing with Australia. The prime minister says, no, we are not going to do that. We are not going to ratify the Kyoto Protocol. One of the major fires happened in Australia, killing more than 80 people, similar to what happened in Portugal a few days ago. And of course, they changed their mind. See? So, I mean, if you don't want to do it, somebody will give you the waking up call. And just a couple of more examples so you can get your coffee. What time? 3:30 or? Okay. I'm getting so excited here that sometimes I keep going and going. And this is just to give you an example from, those percentages could be changing in the last few years, but it's just to say that carbon dioxide is the most important in terms of percentage, and then comes the methane in the second place. Okay? And those values have been increasing. Several observations keep showing that the ice core records, for instance, in the past, and the records from Mauna Loa in Hawaii are showing that the CO2 is increasing. It goes some sort of seasonal cycle, summer and winter, but the tendency is going up, and it hasn't stopped. So it means going and going. Okay. I think we can stop in here with this example, but this isn't the case of the U.S. I took it from the climate change report from the National Academy of Sciences. At the time, the National Academy of Sciences was allowed to do that. I don't think in the future that we'll be allowed to do this. But 82% of the emissions comes from carbon, electric production, transportation in numerous individual processes. The lifetime in the atmosphere, we have 15 to 200 years. The methane comes from livestock, food decomposition, vehicles, black carbon, and natural sources. I mean, so basically, perhaps it changed a bit from country to country, but most of the activities coming. For instance, in Brazil, the energy comes from, most of the 70% of energy comes from water, which is considered clean. But some of the reservoirs in the Amazon, they are basically flooding one part of the Amazon, meaning that the trees are flooded and those trees start to rot and they release methane. So are clean, but not that clean. See, different from solar or energy or wind, which are clean but are quite expensive to produce. At the beginning, perhaps the investment is higher, but on the long term, this investment actually will be paid off. Okay. Well, I think we can stop here for, I don't know, how much? Half an hour, 10 minutes, 5 minutes? 30 minutes. Okay, 30 minutes, and then we come back again. Thank you.